Dear friends, today we will see what is a run test for random sequences. Suppose you were given a data, whether the data is random or not, you can see it by doing the run test. Also, we will see normal distribution and Z variable. And these are all the things we will see in the future videos. What is hypothesis, hypothesis test example, how to conduct an hypothesis test, what is mean by fail to reject null hypothesis, it is a decision, difference between type 1 and type 2 error, which one affects the manufacturer, which one affects the customer, which one is worse, difference between alpha value and beta value, what does alpha mean, what does beta mean, what is an Z test function in Excel sheet, comparing two population proportions using an hypothesis test, chi-square goodness of fit test, one sample t-test, probability using hypothesis testing. So all we will be seeing it in our future videos. At present, we will take care of this random data only. A sequence of data is given. I wonder whether it is occurred by random or not. Then I look at the data, but it may not reveal it. No, it may look like random, but it may not be random. Right? That's why I'll do a test. To determine whether or not it is produced by random, we do this run test. And it is an hypothesis test. What do you mean by hypothesis test? There is a null hypothesis, there is an alternate hypothesis. The procedure for this test is based upon a run or a sequence. That is, it must have a particular characteristics. So I will sequence the data based upon the characteristic. So there must be a characteristic I must use to do the run test. Consider a random number. I ask you to give a random number. You are giving me this random number. So a number, I don't know whether you really have the character to develop a random number or you are biased towards some numbers. So I want to do the test. I am going to use this characteristic. What is this characteristic? The number is even or odd. If it is even, I will use E. If it is odd, I will write O. So I will rewrite this number using E and O. So I have written it here. Again, I'm going to rewrite by combining the E's together. So if there are two E's together, I will combine it as a block. And these two E's, I'll make it as a block. These two O's, I'll make it as a block. These five E's, I'll make it as a block. So I will see how many blocks are there. And each block is called a run, right? Rewrite this so that all of the O's are together and all of the E's are together. Please note that I'm not bringing all the O's together. I'm bringing whichever are together, I'm bringing it together. So this is the rewritten number. So two E's together, I have brought it. Two E's together, I brought it. These five E's together, I brought it. Now I will see the orders, blocks. How many blocks are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 blocks are there, right? And then 10 blocks of even or odd numbers. And see how many runs of data. There are 10 runs of data here, okay? Conditions for run test. The data value from sample should be classified into any one of two categories. Like we have done it, odd or even, right? Heads or tails, like that. Count the total number of runs relative to the number of data values that fall into each category. So number of data that fall into each category, I have made it together, call it as a block, and then counted the number of blocks, which is the number of runs. We have seen it before. It will be a two-sided test. You know why? Two runs. If you do it very less number of data, if you take it, then there won't be enough variation. Right? This is very right, no? Because two times if you toss and if both times you get head, then it may not look like random. But it may be a random process, right? Therefore, two runs, the variation you may not be getting. Therefore, it's not correct. Too many runs, then it will be alternating between various categories. Therefore, it will look as if it is by random, right? Because the process alternate, too many variations will be there. If there are too many variations, it will look as if it's by random, which is not correct, okay? So hypothesis and p-values. Every test of significance, including the run test, has a null and an alternative hypothesis. What is the null hypothesis for run test? The data is random. The data is not random is alternative hypothesis. For the run test, the null hypothesis that the sequence is a random sequence. And the alternative hypothesis that the sequence of sample data is not random. Right? So we can find out the p-value. Right, if the p-value, you know what you mean by p-value. If you do not, we will, you can see it in the other videos, is a probability value for the extreme case and beyond that extreme. Okay, and there are software available, but which are very costly. There are also tables that give the critical numbers at certain level of sequence, like 5%. This is called alpha. Alpha is equal to 0.05. And for a given total number of runs, right? What is the p-value, right? So I ask you to flip a coin 20 times. We will see an example here. And note the order of heads and tails that showed. First of all, you have to give me the data, no? Tomorrow you are bringing the data. But I doubt the data. Let us say you bring this data. There are 20 values. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 heads are there. 11 heads and 9 tails are there. Okay. Remember that. 11 heads and 9, 20 data are there. I suspect whether you actually flipped it. Whether you really flipped the coin and then wrote the numbers, wrote the heads or tails, or just like that wrote on a series of heads and tails that look like random, right? Your own generated or generated by the coin. H naught, the data is random. That is null hypothesis. HA, alternate hypothesis, the data is not random. So what I will do is, I'm going to classify this into two groups as either head or tail. The run test now can help us. I will bring all the H's together, T's together. So regrouping, it becomes, there are 11 runs for the data with, 11 heads and not the 9. It is 11 heads and 9 tails, 20 data are there. I'm sorry for that. This I must cut it out. I'll put it as here. This is 9. This is 11 heads. Okay. And then there are 11 runs there, which you have seen here. Okay. I'll select this. Okay. Now, for a level of significance, I refer the table. For 5% level of significance, for the 20 data, because for the 20 times you have given the data, and the lower and upper limits are given by 4 and 16. So, the reject the null hypothesis when the number of runs is either less than 4 or greater than 16. Between 4 and 16, we should accept the null hypothesis. We fail to reject, means we accept the null hypothesis. Therefore, here we have got 11 runs, which is in between 4 and 16. Therefore, we fail to reject the null hypothesis. That means accept the null hypothesis. It is as per the, there's no question of acceptance at all. It is okay. Whatever is going on is going on. It's a random data only, right? Now, for a large data set, it is not possible to do the run test. So then where we will use the normal approximation requires a number of elements in each category, and then we will find out the total mean, standard deviation, etc. And we call it as a normal distribution. Right. This is the run test table, which we have used before, and 16 are obtained formally from this table. Right. We'll not bother about this. We will see probability and for a value. See, in the x-axis, there is a value, any value you take. And then the probability of that value is, this value may be minus infinity to plus infinity. Please note, right? And the probability for each value is given here. Minus infinity may be close to zero. And it is a particular value. It mean is 0.34. Probability is 0.34. Mean may be any other value. We don't know. Now, suppose I get this mean to be zero, right? The PDF of a normal distribution is defined as f of x is equal to 1 by root of 2 pi sigma x e power minus x minus mu whole squared by 2 sigma x. This is the distribution for which you will get this curve. Now suppose, for example, this mu is nothing but this mean. Sigma is the standard deviation. ST. Right? So I can get this curve by varying this mean as 0. Right? Then find out what is sigma also. See, the PDF of a normal distribution, if the mean is 0, then mu is 0, therefore minus x squared by 2 sigma x comes, right? So it is here. This is the thing. I can put any sigma value and get any normal distribution curve. I can put a sigma value of 1 and then get this curve. Okay, so if you put a sigma value of 1, then the equation is like this. Sigma is equal to 1 here. Sigma is equal to 1 here. I can get this value. I can get this area. This is nothing but an area because total is 1. The integration of this entire minus infinity to plus infinity is equal to 1. So I can find out the probability of occurrence of a number between minus 1 to plus 1 or minus 1 sigma to plus 1 sigma, because sigma is 1 here for this particular distribution. I've taken it. So 68.3% it becomes 0.683. Total area is 1. The area between these two is 0.68. Similarly, the area between minus 3 and plus 3 is 0.997. Therefore, almost the entire data is covered between minus 3 sigma to plus 3 sigma. Understand? So if I get a process with sigma standard deviation very close, say I want a 5 mm diameter and 0.01 is the sigma standard deviation, that the curve will be very narrow curve. No, it will not be so wide. Then that is 3 sigma is 0.01 plus 0.01. This side is 0.02. Total is total deviation is 0.02, right? 5 mm minus 0.01, 5 mm plus 0.01 is what I'm getting. 99% of the products of the items. Yeah. So that is a very good process, 6 sigma process. Yeah. Therefore, you may not be able to understand much here, but this is what is the thing. So we can find out the distribution, a standardized distribution, and the cumulative distribution. The cumulative distribution is this. Right? Cumulative probability distribution is 1 for the entire area. Right? So this is what is a general, distribution will be there, any process. Distribution will be like this. We have to make this to a standardized normal distribution of this form. For this, there is a relation we should use. We should use our population mean, our standard deviation, and this one is the difference between 95% of all the estimates lie within 1.96. Standard error of the mean means, see, standard deviations we refer with respect to a particular value. This is with respect to a particular mean of a sample, right? In a sample, number of data I take, the mean I take, and then I am finding out this deviation, which is standard error. Now, this is what we have seen here. The normal distribution is expressed in standardized form. The relation is Z is equal to X minus mu by sigma X. The mean of the randomized variable Z mu is 0, and the variance is 1, that is sigma X squared is equal to 1. The PDF of the standardized normal distribution is then simplified to f of x 1 by root of 2 pi e power minus z squared by 2. So I am going to use this z value and then use this table, normalized distribution table, and then find out this cumulative distribution and find out the probability of occurrence within a particular standard deviation. Okay. Clear. This is how I'm going to use the normal distributions for finding out my process is a 6 sigma process or not. Right? The Z variable, I'm going to use it here. Right? So if my Z variable lies here, then the 94% area, the Z value lies here, then 95% of the data lie within this plus or minus 2 sigma. We will be doing more examples in the later videos. You'll be able to appreciate that. The videos will be like this. What is an hypothesis? The test hypothesis example. The procedure for conducting hypothesis test for chi-square test, t-test, and z-test. And comparing two population proportions with hypothesis test. All these things, we will see it in the future videos. Thank you.